Please stand as you're able. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, who alone does wondrous things.
Blessed be God's name forever.
Amen. Beloved, now is the time to wait for you. Let us confront our sins and confess them to the one who is merciful and just. God of new beginnings, we have confessed that we have not come from your holy way. We have strayed from your paths. We prepare for war with your enemies. We dishonor one another in your creation. Purify us with your repentant heart and set us again on your way of love, that we may bear fruit worthy of repentance and not be blinded among us. Amen. People of God, a new thing is growing in our midst, a tender branch, a living vine. By water and the Spirit, you are enjoying through this wonder. You have put on Christ, and your sins have been washed away. Rejoice in the way of the Lord.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
We continue with our song of praise.
So tired and finally fell asleep at 3 a.m. and you slept all the way through. school days? You slept through all of Christmas morning? Do you have family that you go see at Christmas or that come see you?
Yeah.
That's right, if you heard a noise, you'd come down and see Santa. So you would sleep through getting open presents from Santa, right?
And you would miss getting to eat all of that delicious food that you get at Christmas and see family and playing with your
toys or games or activities that you get. Do you guys go anywhere on Christmas and do anything special? Usually? Yeah. So you'd miss out on seeing your grandma and grandpa, right? Yeah, so we miss out on a lot of really fun things on Christmas. Exactly. So, I bring this up because in our scripture lesson, Jesus is warning the disciples about not necessarily sleeping through Christmas, but sleeping through the gift that Jesus brings. We know that we celebrate Christmas because it's the birth of Jesus, right? And so, if we aren't focused on the season, we might miss that gift, the gift that baby Jesus brings, which is the forgiveness of our sins. And so, we're entering a time in the church year called Advent. That's why we lit this cool Advent wreath with candles up there. And so it's a time for us to prepare for the arrival of that gift that Jesus brings. And so for the next few weeks, we will do that. We'll get prepared and get ready for that gift, the birth of Jesus, and the forgiveness of our sins. And just like we wouldn't ever want to sleep through Christmas, we don't want to sleep through the gifts that Jesus brings and that he shares with us. We're going to focus on opening our eyes, and our ears, and our mouths, and our hearts over the next 4 weeks. So be ready to celebrate on Christmas. And that is the good news that we have for today. Can we say a word of prayer? Prayer positions. Dear God, thank you for Jesus, who teaches us to stay awake and to bring about your better way by sharing your love and grace with others. Thank you. Thanks for coming up here this morning. You can head back to your seats, and we will continue with the readings.
The first reading this morning is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 2, beginning with verse 1. The word that Isaiah, son of Amos, saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. In days to come, the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established as the highest of the mountains, and shall be raised above the hills. All the nations shall spring to it. Many peoples shall come and say, come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob. And he may teach us his ways, so that we may walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth instruction, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. And he shall judge between the nations, and shall arbitrate for many peoples. They shall beat their swords into plowshares, and their spears into pruning. Nations shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. O house of Jacob, come let us walk in the light of the Lord. Word of God, word of life, thanks be to God. Now, we will read Psalm 122, and we will do this responsibly. I was glad when they said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Our feet are standing within your gates, O Jerusalem. Jerusalem, built as a city that is bound firm together.
To the tires of the Lord, the tires of the Lord, as it was pretty for the city.
For there are thrones of judgment which are set up, the thrones of the house of David.
Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May they prosper and promote you.
Peace be within your walls, and security within your tower.
For the sake of my relatives and friends, I will say, peace be within you.
For the sake of the house of the Lord, our God, I will seek your name. The second reading is from the book of Romans, chapter 13, beginning with verse 11. this. You know what time it is. How is it now the moment for you to wake from your sleep? For salvation is nearer to us now than when we became believers. The night is far gone. The day is near. Let us then lay aside the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us live honorably as in the day, not in reveling and drunkenness, not in debauchery and licentiousness, not in quarreling and jealousy. Instead, put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand in the altar.
Talked about the car group that she was involved in and a lot of other things too. that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened, and the words are hope, riches, glorious inheritance, great power for us who believe. Tough to read the small end of it, but this is a wonderful verse in Ephesians. And the text that we read from the Gospel was when they bring the baby Jesus to the temple, Mary and Joseph. Here is this really old man and a really old woman. Now to us, you know, like 84 is not really elderly, because a lot of us and our friends lived into triple figures. But back then, it was incredible. So we have Simeon and we have Anna. This is one of the paintings of Simeon and Anna, with Simeon holding the baby Jesus and Mary and Joseph off to the side. Simeon has this wonderful prayer in Latin. It's called the Nunc Dimittis. And I like the words of it in the old RSV, Simeon says, "For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared before the face of all people, a light to lighten the Gentiles and the glory of your people in Israel." What a marvelous praise. This is what Simeon's been waiting for, to have his eyes see the salvation coming. And he sees the baby Jesus. Anna then comes in, and Anna begins to speak about Jesus as well. Anna is a prophet. She's been in the temple for a long time. Luke does this all the time. He has men and women together as equals helping spread the gospel. One of the, a lot more than Matthew, Mark, and John. He lifts up the place of women, thank God, in the scripture. Now, the Gospel of John has many references to Jesus as light. He said, a few of the verses, and I didn't list all the references because you've heard all these so many times. "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of the life." And then when he's healing, I think the man going blind, he says, "As long as I am in the world, I am Jesus does a lot of analogies in the Gospel of John, but light is one of the most powerful ones. In John chapter 12, we have these verses. "Now among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and they said to him, 'Sir, we wish to see Jesus.'" "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Words with power. There are several illustrations. I mean, Luke has one, John has one, where people, they now kind of know who Jesus' disciples are. And it's tough to get to Jesus because of crowds, or else he's already left going somewhere. So they talk to his disciples and say, "We want to see Jesus. Can you help us? Can you take us there?" Lots of great paintings in history about that situation. "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." And this is, I think, is really true. Every Christian preacher will tell you that this is the goal of every sermon preached from every book. I don't care about the denomination. Every time a pastor or anybody speaking gets up in the pulpit, this is what they hope to do. It's as if the Holy Spirit taps me on the shoulder as I get up there and reminds me what every single person seeing or hearing is hoping for. "Jim, we wish to see Jesus." "Jim, we want you to tell us of Jesus and what he has done. And make it so clear somehow that the Holy Spirit will shine in the face of Christ before each of us, so we will time to present Christ, kind of lift it up. And the response will be whatever the Holy Spirit does of each person who sees, who hears. Now, when Jesus did miracles of healing in the Gospels and he gave people their sight, which was a big thing that he did, sometimes it was immediate, sometimes it was gradual. Sometimes they were told to go, you know, do something first, like wash in the pool or put clay in your eyes, and they were healed then gradually. Jesus, I mean, there's no set formula. If you just do this, Jesus will always heal this person. It's not how it works. It's not magic. But Jesus gave people their sight so they could see him and so they could behold him. So they can worship. I love this picture, this painting. The man born blind, Jesus is touching his eyelids so he can see. There's a connection in many gospel stories about Jesus between seeing and hearing. Seeing and hearing are two things that go together. And we could have had the first talk about open your ears. But we decided to go and open your eyes, and then next week we'll be able to open your ears. But they're really connected, aren't they? I mean, how many times have you had your friends tell you, oh, I went to this marvelous, you know, place for supper, or I went on vacation to this wonderful place, and when you hear that, you know, I need to go see for myself. Or I need to take the family, and we need to see for ourselves. This is even true in the Gospels. After, you know, on Easter morning, the women go to the tomb, and they're there first, and they see the stone rolled back, and then depending on which Gospel story you're at, sometimes they see the angels, and the angels tell them he's risen. Mary sees Jesus, but doesn't know who he is right away until he speaks to her. And then, no matter what the case is, the women go back and tell the men. What's the man's response? Oh, are you sure you saw that? We better go see for ourselves. And then the men have to hurry in the tomb. And it's John and Peter, usually the two that go there first. And you remember this story about Mary? And Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white, seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head, the other at the foot. And they asked the woman, why are you crying? And they've taken my Lord away. She said, hey, I don't know where they've put him. At this, she turned around. And she saw Jesus standing there, but she didn't know that it was Jesus. And there are so many paintings of how that could have happened. She doesn't know that's Jesus. She thinks it's the gardener until he speaks her name. And he goes, Mary. And then she goes, my Lord. Speaking, seeing, and hearing are all connected. Now Mary Magdalene, that lady, goes to the disciples with the news, I have seen the Lord, and she told them that he had said these things to her. But again, like I said, the men have to say, well, we need to go see for ourselves. Who's the best example of a guy who needs to see for himself? He was given the name Doubting. Doubting Thomas. He, even though all the other disciples said, we've seen the Lord, he appeared to so many people and to us, and Thomas goes, I see him and see the scars, I'm not going to believe it. We want to kind of say that's cynical, but I think that's pretty normal. And we want to receive for ourselves. And Paul, the Apostle Paul, says, in this life, we do not see clearly. We have moments, maybe, when we can see clearly, and we know clearly, and we believe positively, and we're sure of ourselves and of our faith and of ourselves. sometimes seeing as believing. Other times, maybe the Holy Spirit is to kind of tap us on the shoulder and go, oh, yeah, I'm still here. You can believe in me a different way now, or at a deeper level, but I'm still here. I'm still the Lord. Let's keep on our journey together. So in this life, like Paul said, we don't see clearly. What's the phrase point? We see through a glass darkly. It's like we've got sunglasses on in the middle of the night. It's like when you first wake up after a deep sleep, and you've got to kind of rub your eyes so you can focus and see a little better. Or if you're like me, you get up and you kind of reach for your glasses, because then you can see a little clearly. Before that, things get a little blurred, even if you're nearsighted or frustrated. That's us. We don't always see clearly. But the good news is that Jesus always sees us, loves us, comes to us, and forgives us. So the good news this morning in open is that Jesus' eyes are always open. The Bible says, he who watches Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. I mean, Jesus sees our deeds, just as he hears our prayers, just as he understands our hearts. Jesus never has to be awake. When he was alive on earth, and a human being like you and me, he would get tired. He would take naps. And even out in the middle of the lake, he had to take a nap in the boat because he was exhausted. But then he woke up when the winds and the waves were bouncing, and he just said two words, be still. And the storm stopped, and the waves stopped. But now he sees us all the time, loves us all the time, forgives us all the time. He's always watching and waiting and wanting us to return to him and to say, well, there I am again, God. Help me to continue to live my life and show me what I ought to do next. So here's our theme for the Sundays. Open your eyes. Next week, open your ears and open your heart. We're going to probably skip open your mouth because that's a Sunday school program. And we will hear a lot of open your mouth on that Sunday anyway, as the kids share their speaking and singing parts. So open your eyes.
to you, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. You may be seated. The joy and the peace we are given through the cross of Jesus Christ. Please consider your gift designed to strengthen our ministry and mission together for the sake of all need of your Christ's love and grace and death. You can give online to a male or a person here today. Children everywhere are invited to come forward and place their offerings in the worship of our door box and throughout the sanctuary. Thank you for your gracious gift designed for your partnership in the gospel.
You may be seated. The ushers will guide you.
I
you stand as our own? And then the bottom blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who you receive, strengthen you and keep you unto eternal life. Amen. Let us pray together. Faithful God, in this field you have remembered your mercy, living heaven and earth in the body and blood of Christ. As we wait for the day when all your promises will be fulfilled, sustain us and strengthen us by this holy mystery. Guide us toward the promised future, coming to the earth in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. God, the eternal Word, who dwells with us in Jesus, and who holds us in the grace of the Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen.
We conclude with our sending song.